So the headline for the next session is Smart Cities 101, and the person who's going to take us through this is Dr. Larissa Romualdo Suzuki, who's really been everywhere working for and with everyone who's anyone in the field of digital development. You might even say for the common good. Very excited and proud to welcome her to the stage. A warm hand.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here. So I'm Larissa Suzuki. I will be navigating you through the world of smart cities and what that is and why that is so important to us, especially practitioners in the field of IoT. So IoT is the answer for all the problems we have today in the city environment. So the key takeaways for my session is, what are smart cities? Why we should care about this? Why they are so relevant to us? The role of the Internet of Things in helping us to ensure that we have a sustainable society with economic growth and that citizens, they have a good quality of life. Using devices as intelligent asset to enable circular economy, to enable us to understand how we can repurpose and reuse physical assets as much as possible. And also the concept of using data as infrastructure. So we don't have the separation of bits and atoms anymore. So we have the digital side of things embedded into the physical infrastructure. So we have to ensure we manage data in the way we manage transport, water, and energy, because we need data to make intelligent decisions. The road ahead, what we need to do to ensure that smart cities, they become for everyone and not just for a small side of the population, because we are not going to solve any problem at all if we do not tackle every single problem we have, and the importance of being outcome-oriented. So it's nice to have sensors everywhere, but we have to understand where to apply so that cities that can use their monetary resources to build houses and homes and make sure that everybody is welcome in the city. So let me start to give you a background. So cities, historically, they are known for being the main disseminators and consumers of innovation. So cities, they are globalized, and they provide an environment where people can trade, do business, and also succeed. And cities are also known to make people happier, because they have access to better education and healthcare and housing, and they can also have opportunities to prosper, to set up their own business and many other things. And because of this, every single day, 150,000 people, they move into cities, creating a load of demand for infrastructure services in the city. And then we can see that this is a world demand. It's happening everywhere. So people are moving to urban environment, putting pressure on cities that are already struggling to provide services for the people already living there. And we could just think, okay, let's just like increase the supply of electricity, let's just increase the supply of water, and we're gonna be all right. But this is not how cities work. So the infrastructure of cities, they have evolved through many vintages of technology, often along different paths. So transport depends upon energy, energy depends upon water, but those systems, they become fragmented as they become independent organizations providing their own services. And because they don't have a common sense, a common understanding of growth is coming, where supply, we need to put supply to support the demand, because they don't have this understanding, cities, they fail in supporting the upcoming population emerging in cities. And this fragmented scenario makes cities, utilities, and services to operate not in an optimal scenario. So just so we understand the problem that we have in cities today, so this is just some information about all the monetary laws we have in cities today. So buildings, they're responsible for 60 to 80% of energy consumption, and they're responsible for nearly 300 billions of euros in energy waste every single year. And in food waste is also another problem. We throw away nearly 200 billion of euros in food. And you know what? In the next 6 months alone, 20 million people are gonna be starved. And we have over three quarters of a billion people starving across the globe. And we produce a lot of food, we throw them away, and we waste 500 trillion euros every single year watering the food we are going to throw away. And 1 in 9 people around the planet, they are undernourished. So we produce the food, we have the capacity to produce, but then we waste the food and we waste the resources that we use to produce the food. And then congestion is another problem, because every single human who is a driver spends around 4 months of their lives stuck in traffic trying to find a bloody parking space. And this is quite annoying, because that creates a lot of pollution too, because and the pollution affects us, our health. So 5.5 million people, they die every single year as a consequence of air pollution. And that not only affects us healthily, but also our cognitive ability. So a study done in Israel some years ago demonstrated that air pollution affects our cognitive ability. So kids, when they are near to polluted places, they do very badly on tests because they become more ill, and that impacts their ability to join a good university because they get bad grades. So it really impacts the people that we become in the future, because our health gets really undermined because of this. So you understand the gravity of the situation. This G here is the Google annual profit. So when we compare the amount of money a successful organization makes and the amount of money we throw away, we really have got to do something about it. And another problem that we have is, like, we are really relying on finite resources. Those things are going to go away, and we cannot replace them. And we are not yet exploring the full potential of renewable sources of energy. And because we have a lot of people coming to cities, that will create a demand of 2.5 billion of people, new residents by 2050. If we put all these people, like, this into perspective of a daily demand, to support the 2.5 billion people coming to cities by 2050, we needed to build nearly 2,000 apartment buildings every single day, each one with capacity of around 100 people. And the majority of those homes, they have to be affordable, because we have people living from rural areas, countryside, coming to the city. So we have to ensure they can afford to have a good quality of life. So basically, we have an increased demand in services. We don't have the ability to provide those services at a good quality. We need to have more resources efficiency and also enable a circular economy. Basically, a circular economy is a process in which you fully exploit the life cycle of a resource. So for instance, if we have a building and then the parts of those buildings, if we knew their purpose, their location, their context, when that building were decommissioned, we could get the parts and put in another building, resell, we could get the waste that some people are interested in, the waste produced by construction industry, we could send the waste for those people. So it's exploiting the full potential, not throw away everything, but find new ways to reuse them. So this is enabling the circular economy. And also we need to create cost-effective solutions. So cities, they have a very tight budget. They cannot spend billions on things, and they need cost-effective stuff that will reduce the cost of operation and will increase their capacity to provide services to citizens. So I have two basic questions. We have two basic questions that we have to ask. The first one is, how can our economy survive in the future years? And how can we ensure city systems work together in an orchestrated way so they understand the demand that we put in, and then they can provide the supply? So basically, I'm asking how the success for cities, they look like, how we can solve the problems that we have today. And we have like 5 basic challenges and things that we have to enable. That is a more integrated network of systems. So if I understand I need to provide, I have more increase in transport, I can provide more energy, and then which will need more water, so we can have more coordinated orchestration of infrastructure. If I know a lot of people are moving to cities, I can be better prepared to provide the homes. We need adaptive and responsive infrastructure. So when there is a problem, like an explosion, or when there is a leak, or when there is a faulty bridge, or even transport, we can recover from unpredictable situations. enable the circular economy again, and enable cyber-physical system. The cyber-physical system is not only about connecting systems and data, it's about also connecting them with people. Because people is an essential part of smart cities. We cannot just build a smart city just with sensors, with technology. We need the people, because we can use people as sensors. And people, they understand what goes around, what is the context, and they really understand the demand and how to measure quality of service. And it's quite difficult for machines to give us that answer. And also behavioral change. Because people, they become more aware of their consumption patterns, they can change. They can stop wasting energy, they can stop wasting water, so they become more conscious about the effects and the impacts we put on the planet, especially when they understand that we have finite resources that we might never get back again. So for us to tackle these issues, the answer is on data. So if we collect data, we process this data, we put data together, we infuse the data back into the system, we can understand how we can optimize resources, where demand is, we can understand the network capacity to provide connectivity, to provide electricity and water and basic public services for people. And the answer to capture all that data is in connecting the bits and atoms, which is the power of the IoT. So the Internet of Things, all of you, that you are all, you know, I mean, some of you are all experts, you understand what the Internet of Things is, so I'm not going to go in technical detail, but the idea of the Internet of Things is connecting devices all over the internet, is to ensure we have capacity to understand how our assets work. When we put this into the city context, it gives us the ability to understand the location of our assets, the purpose of them, how we can reuse them, and how they are operating. So if we know a device is not working pretty well, a bridge is kind of becoming weak, we can do predictive maintenance. We don't need to wait for the bridge to collapse for us to go and do something. So, and the Internet of Things falls within the fourth industrial revolution. So we had the first industrial revolution where we had the steam and water and mechanism for us to produce stuff. And then in the second industrial revolution, we had division of labor and mass production that was followed in the late 60s by the digital revolution when we had electronics and automation. And now, so if we look, we created tools here. Here we optimized assets. Here we created an ability for us to manage knowledge because we have the digital infrastructure. And then in here, we are using knowledge to create new knowledge, which means we can optimize what we have in place in the cities today. So when we merge people, assets, and systems, we are able to get knowledge. And that knowledge can create context-aware, reflective cities that understand, okay, for my own city, those are the requirements, because the one-size-fits-all approach will never work. Cities that have different citizens, they are digitally ready in different ways. So some cities, they are more advanced. Other cities, they are not that advanced. But still, technology can be infused to create better things for citizens. But we have to understand the context of the citizens, the context of the city, so that we can ensure that the IoT can create good things. And then the market for IoT is huge, especially like in the cities and outside, which includes transport and logistics, homes, smart homes. We need a lot of IoT effort put in place to enable us to have predictive maintenance, to ensure that homes are safe for people to live in, and also offices. So people all the time, they complain, oh, I don't have space in my office. Research has shown that 60% of the time, rooms they are not used, even at office time, and people complain, oh, I don't have any room. But it's because we don't understand how rooms they are used. We could repurpose them if we understand that only 3 people go to a room that can accommodate 20 people. So we can repurpose the building to ensure that rooms, they're modular, so you can serve better, more people. And also IoT reduce the cost of transactions because you can have a common platform that you can put in the data, collect the data, and process this. And also decreases the coordination cost because you can have a centralized way for you to manage everything that is in there. You don't have to go through many different systems across the buildings. I'm going to give you an example later about the problem of fragmentation. And McKinsey predicts that it can reduce maintenance costs by 20%, can cut unplanned outages by 50%, because if you know you're going to have problems in energy supply, you can take actions before the worst happen. And also you can extend the lives of machines, because you understand a machine if that is faulty before that crashes and stops working. So we have a new design. We have a shift in design, a shift in how we perceive the environment. So this is an example of what we call buildings. Yeah? In the built environment in the past, we had a lot of legacy system. So we had a dedicated device served by a proprietary ICT infrastructure serving application A. For you to serve application B, you had to come here and do everything again. Very fragmented, isolated, different communication protocols and standards. They couldn't talk with each other. So in building, you ended up having trillions of systems that were so difficult to maintain to design because they are fragmented and you had vendor locking. And becomes very difficult also for you to customize and evolve that system. The IoT gives us the power to resolve that fragmentation because we can sync data together into a common platform. We can explore how we can use more common standards, how we can make use of open technology to ensure that we collect information, we share that information also with partners and people who are interested in our data. So for instance, I am a building, I'm collecting data for energy usage. I can share my data with the grid. So the grid knows this building will consume X amount of energy so they can better meet supply with the demand. And that's why we avoid having outages. And also IoT enables us to repurpose assets. So we are not longer attached to an asset that has a single purpose. So today we can see as a lamp post as a multi-purpose device. We can use that device to sense the environment, to sense air pollution, also to check if we have a parking space available, and that data can go to a platform that will go to an application to enable people to find parking place, and we can also monitor flow. So the possibilities are endless. With IoT, we are no longer attached to a single vendor or to a single kind of thinking. So there's a lot for us to do. When we look to applied IoT in smart cities, there are so much things that we can do. So for instance, in smart agriculture, people are devoting a lot of time working with precision agriculture. So we can use drones to go to fly over a very big plantation crop. We can understand the health of the crops. And if we spot a place, a small tiny place with problem with some pest, we can apply pesticide in that location only. So research has shown that use of drones and IoT in precision agriculture can reduce the use of pesticide by 99% in small farms. So think about the impact that that brings to local producers and also to your health, because we're going to be consuming food with less pesticides and we're going to have a much longer life. In precision agriculture, people are also using farm bots, and this is the farm bot. So you can apply seeds in a specific location, and then you can move that farm bot along your land. That will avoid erosion and damage caused to the soil, and you can be very precise with the location where you're putting your seeding. And that also enables you to tackle where problems are so that you can remove them from your plantation. And also, you can also send drones to see, to test how much water you need to put in a particular place. So instead of watering everything at all times, wasting water, you can just check, oh, is my soil okay? Do I need to put more water on it? And then you can just sense and then apply things as you need instead of just doing this at large scale, wasting resources. So precision agriculture is a very big field, and there's a lot of need for work in that area. We also have application for smart waste. Smart waste, so this is an example of smart bins that you can put in cities. You can track if people are recycling, how much that is, and because then you can put more effort in particular regions to incentivize people to recycle more. And also, you can, because you can sense what's inside that bin, you can send, you know, information for logistic companies to go and pick up that waste. So you kind of speed up the process and enable a more efficient waste collection. There's a very amazing product that I like a lot that is called the Strawberry Tree. And so they provide like solar panels in the shape of trees, and then they provide electricity, energy for people to charge phones, to charge their own devices, and also collect information about weather, also Wi-Fi, and many other things. So it's different ways for us to apply technology to create community engagement, also create new sources of energy to preserve what we have today. And another a project that is quite interesting that goes back to what I said about exploring the wisdom of the crowds is the Oxford Float Network. So this project works by giving sensors to the community for them to measure a floating next to their homes. So instead of the city going and putting all those sensors everywhere, the user becomes the owner of the sensor and becomes responsible to collect the data, to gather the data, and also to share with their peers. And by bringing people to be part of the data processing, removes a lot of barriers in trust, in security, and also people being afraid, oh, I'm going to be spied on, like smart meters. So by involving people more on the data processing side and understanding the applicability of technology removes a lot of barrier in user acceptance of technology being infused in their homes and in their locations. And also enables more data collection and more precise because users, they become more responsible. If they find a problem in sensors, they can also inform the responsible people to go in and replace this. So they use this to measure flood near the Oxford River, and it's quite effective. And this community engagement project has created a lot of benefits because people can also alert other people, like there's flood coming in, go and do something to avoid the water coming inside of your house and damaging the things that you have. So if we think about like smart cities as a kind of a design principle, we have to think about this in a way that data is shared among people who can help us to deliver smart cities. So it's really impossible for us to specialize on every single thing we need in smart city. It's really, really impossible. And then what we miss today is merging the top-down approaches and the bottom-up approaches. So for instance, we have government coming in infusing, I'm going to put this here, I need 4G over there, I need X, Y, and Z, without much consulting the citizens. So they care too much about 5G, but a lot of places in cities, they have no connectivity at all. So it's more like understanding how the top-down government initiatives can support the bottom-up approaches. For instance, the Oxford Float Network, if they received funding to support that, or at least place for them to store data, that could help them a lot to succeed in their initiatives. And then, so we have to have a collection of providers and experts providing, you know, services for data processing, artificial intelligence, data analytics, sensors expertise, and also having the citizens involved and also government not infusing stuff without understanding our needs. So this basic principle is that once data is collected from cross domain services, from utilities, from like homes, from energy usage, that data can be integrated, shared across different sectors and stakeholders, and you have a data infrastructure that can enable new services to be created, can enable applications, and also business models. So if you see in London, let me give an example from London. So Transport for London, they have a lot of data about transport. So they didn't have a data strategy to, what do I do with this data? Instead of kind of locking in this data, they said, I'm going to put this out there and let's see what people do. So today we have 450 apps built just with the data Transport for London put out there. And that is how CityMapper emerged. So you have all those businesses being created with the data that you put out. So instead of Transport for London saying, I'm not going to create an app, leave people to find their way, they outsourced the apps to the experts who are the app developers, and then they created the technology for them. And it also happens with Uber. So Uber, they don't own any taxi, and yet they are one of the largest taxi providers. Airbnb, they do not own one single room, yet they are one of the largest hotel provider on the planet, and they compete with the Hilton and very big organizations. So the idea is like collectively, we can solve the urban challenges we have today. So cities alone, government, they cannot do this themselves. And so just to summarize some of the ideas for us to look into IoT-driven smart city solutions, one key point that I would like to highlight is the need to have a business case to create applications. So I see around many cities just saying, oh, I want this sensor here, that sensor over there, but they're not focusing on solving a particular problem. And that creates, you know, trouble because you collect data, you clutter data that you don't need, and then you put technology that your users, they are not ready for this. So instead of wasting $1 million with like a panel to show tweets, let's try to focus on solving real urban challenges that will improve mobility of people, perhaps focusing more on disabled people. They're not much work done to solve mobility of disabled people, visually impaired, and many people with difficulties in mobility. So let's have a more outcome-oriented approach, focus more on smart cities problem, and be context-aware. Smart cities has to be for all. So if you provide a service, an IoT service for, you know, improved mobility, focus on every single citizen a city might have. Try to understand the demographics. If they're more senior people, how you're going to ensure they can interact with the technology. If more disabled people, try to find ways to make sure the technology can be transferred to them too. And have the concept of managing data as infrastructure, so you have a proper collection, proper integration, and sharing this with the people that can benefit the most. And also, for government themselves, there's a need to invest in people to understand how they're going to interface with those technology and also other organizations. For instance, there are a lot of work done in the construction sector, so using drones and many things to go over lands, but sometimes the users, they don't have the expertise to interact with those technology, so there's a need to invest more in that too. And also the TQ, so we have the IQ and then we have the TQ, that is like the technical expertise, technical savviness. We also have to have this so that we understand what technology can do and we are not afraid of that. And collaborate more across industries, remove the barrier. We together as a collective whole, we can do much things. So in IoT, we need more standards, we need more open technology, and we need people to help us to translate technology into real solution for cities. Early prototype of solutions. Think about if Amazon worked in the same way government work, like testing for like taking like a year to put a website up. So it's really not sustainable. So we have to prototype, test with our users, and try to find a way to put those things in the market. So early prototyping is quite important in smart cities too, especially because the field is changing a lot as new technology coming in. And also have measurable KPI. So if you we deliver an IoT solution to solve mobility problem or energy problem, how am I contributing to the smart city vision of that particular city? Am I providing support to the sustainable capital? Am I providing support to the human capital? So we have to have measurable, you know, critical success factors that will enable us to put what we do into context, also for the entire of society. Thank you very much, guys.
Like you know the drill, taking the nice seat.
Oh, I was supposed to be there.
No, that's the way it's supposed to be. That's good. Thank you so much. Captivating presentation. Panelists, what did you think?
As we work with Stockholm City, and they're great to work with. But one of the things they're terrified about in the area of IoT is vendor lock-in, because they work with companies and companies initially can be great, but then the people at the company change, and then maybe the aim of the company changes. And so that plus the whole procurement process in Sweden is a little bit cumbersome. They sort of have this dilemma of working with other organizations. Do you have any lessons that you can maybe communicate that how we can help cities deal with those problems?
Well, I do think that If we put this into context of IoT, for instance, worked on, you know, to ensure that we have, you know, open standards and agreements and those kind of things that enable devices and technology to interoperate might remove those challenges. Because if today we continue adopting this closed system approach, we're going to invest a lot of money today, but in 10 years, we're going to have the same problems again because we're not going to solve this kind of vendor lock-in. So I feel like there's a lot that us, like techies, like in the tech sector, doing work in IoT can do that is, you know, develop more common standards, common agreements, and ensuring that we have a more open platform approach and technology approach in a way that we're going to solve that barriers and we will enable cities to pull, you know, input and technology from multiple parties. It's like creating a value network of partners, but we have to talk the same language. We have to talk, you know, the same kind of technology. So I feel like more development on the field of like standards and those kind of agreements will help us to move a lot from away from this problem of having vendor lock-in.
So you've done obviously a lot of research on smart cities. Who do you think are some companies that are really pioneers in this space that you also think are taking into account security as well as programs in place to help educate consumers in order for this to scale? Because I think given if we're looking at all the talks that we had this morning, I mean, you're talking about security, systems not being built first, focused on the needs of people, which you brought up. But I think there's really a major issue in terms of, I think the devices and the systems have to be right first before I feel that I feel comfortable even engaging and building and thinking about a completely smart city. So who do you think some of the pioneers are and companies in this space that really are taking into account all those different factors?
Well, to be honest, I would say none from my experience. Because like, so I chair the Tech London Advocates Smart Cities Group. And we had a meeting one day that we had done into a room. We brought everybody, like disabled people, visually impaired. We got a lot of people together, and then we asked them the question, what do you think a smart city is to you? And then we're naming cities with like fancy stuff going around, drones. And then at the end of the meeting, when we really looked into what a smart city is, we asked the same question again. And they all said, none. There's no smart city around. And then I think it's because government, they should be more open to have this kind of discussion. Because what I feel is like maybe some organizations that try to have the conversation, but it's technology, people who are experts on technology and security issues, they're not invited into the conversation. And this is what I feel a lot of times. So, and then I sometimes take part in some, you know, round table discussion in the European Commission and other places, but I see most of the people sitting there making the decisions, they do not have a proper understanding on the issues, especially security issue like data processing and using blockchain and using those kind of technologies to manage like crowdsourced data, how that will impact, you know, having personal data stored in social technologies. So I feel like we don't have much companies collaborating with this because I think they're not invited into the conversation too. It's not like they don't want, but I feel like the decision makers creating smart cities, they are not really inviting the real experts. Because sometimes people refer to people, technologists as the nerds, but in fact we are the experts. And then we have to be invited into the conversation because we can contribute and give the answers to address security issues because it's very technical. It's very technical in its own nature. It's not only saying we need secure stuff, we need to understand the mechanisms to put security into place. So I feel like, to summarize, we don't have much pioneers on this. People are trying, but because they're not invited much into the conversation, especially startups, there are many startups around working with security, with machine learning, and many things, but sometimes they're invisible because they're not giving much of the chance to sit at the table and really discuss and help us to shape and reshape cities.
Don't you think, though, that it's often a question of that they really don't know what they're going to do with it? I mean, this would be really cool, but what real problem does it actually solve? And sometimes we start with the technology and say, we got this technology, can we use that in some cool way, rather than turning it around and saying, we got this problem. Maybe these solutions could help that. How about we, who are especially interested, start by addressing the big issues of society and then see how we can apply it rather than going the other way
around? Yes, and that's why what I mean by having an outcome-oriented approach. Because what I see today is like a lot of marketing stuff, people wanting to be the most smartest city ever on the galaxy, and then they just want to have a lot of sensors and drones and having a cool city. It's okay, but we have to be outcome-oriented because also collecting a lot of data, putting sensors everywhere might not solve most of the problem. And sometimes they can become counterproductive. Like we had problems with 9/11, so they had all the data they needed to predict the 9/11, so the 9/11 Commission found that, but yet they missed. So we created a lot of problems by also not being outcome-oriented, so it becomes counterproductive at some point.
Mm. Any questions from the crowd? Then I'm sure Larissa will be happy to take them. Otherwise, now we're gonna have lunch pretty soon, so there's gonna be time for you to catch up with all of our speakers and also our panelists, of course. Any other reflections, Anna?
Yeah, I just want to know what's your opinion about integrity, of course, because people are terrified that you can, in smart cities, predict their behavior and that kind of stuff. So I think you probably get that question a lot.
Yeah.
What about the?
Yes. And I feel like citizens, again, I think they feel much from my interaction with them, they feel much what we feel, that because they're not brought into the conversations, they do not understand the technology and the mechanism behind that technology that can protect them. Because they don't understand this, they get terrified of what they're going to do with that data. So we have a problem with communication, we don't communicate enough, we're not transparent enough, and we don't invest much into people so they can understand also not how that technology will be applied and the data collected, but also how they can be more secure aware so that when they see something weird is happening, they can act, they can understand that there's a threat in something. So I do think that, you know, we also have the communication problem also in enabling the society to understand the benefits of smart cities. And maybe that's why we don't have yet a fully smart city yet, because of all acceptance. We have to build public acceptance. And for this, people have to be very clear about trust, security, privacy, and many other things that goes around collecting their data and acting on them automatically, because we want to use a self-adaptive system to react to unpredictable situation. So how that will impact me as a citizen, most of people, they don't know.
Well, if you look back in just regular internet issues, it's always a question of when we're comfortable. I mean, only 5 years ago, people wouldn't even give out their credit card information when they book a hotel room because they didn't feel good about it. And then they started to notice that this is so convenient that I'm not going to be scared anymore because it's so convenient. So convenient always beats scared. So again, the right technology and the right solution, we will stop worrying about these things.
Yes.
It's my prediction, but yeah. I'm not sure if you agree.
Yeah, I agree. But also, people have to get told those things. So for instance, if I buy your technology to put in my city, you know, I will be comfortable because I know you put security measurements behind this. I will be comfortable. But what about the citizens? Most of the time, they're not told. So how they can just easily accept, oh yeah, put sensors in my house, I'm cool with this. So we have to ensure like they understand that we are doing something that has been thought through and that, you know, people are kind of responsible for that technology and they're gonna take any measure to ensure there's no security breach or anything else. A lot of people, they were so concerned with smart metering. You could know if the person was watching TV, if the person was at home, what the person was doing, and blah, blah, blah. People, they got very scared. And a lot of smart metering initiatives, they got held back because people were, oh my God, no, I don't want this in my home. And also, they did not know the full benefit of integrating energy consumption from houses to the grid. So because, like, we don't tell them, how we are going to expect them to just accept and say, oh, yeah, put meters in my home. So it's a communication problem.
There's a lot of teaching work to be done. Now, before we head out to lunch, I'd just like to thank this morning's panel, because we're going to get new panelists after lunch. So, Jewel, Barry, and Anna, thank you so much for sitting in, taking the time and helping us out. A warm hand for the panelists. Larissa, of course, thank you for a lovely presentation. Lunch is really quite self-explanatory. It's out there. It's good food. See you back at 1:30. Thank you.
the car.